before we have a complete runaway. Genesis chapter, we're not above that. I said, we're not above that. I've been here for a month and we've had several runaways already. A runaway is just fine with me. I'd rather have a runaway than hear me preach for. And everybody said, some of you are chicken. Say amen. Genesis chapter 26, verse 1 through 25. And I understand it's a lot of reading. I'll not read all of it. We'll read down to verse 7, then we'll skip to verse 15. Genesis chapter 26. Thank you so much for joining us in this service today. Genesis 26, verse 1. The Bible said there was a famine in the land besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar. Then the Lord appeared to him and said, "Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land of which I shall tell you. Dwell in this land, and I will be with you, and I will bless you, for to you and your descendants I give all these lands. And I will perform the oath which I swore to Abraham your father, and I will make your descendants multiply as the stars of heaven. And I will give your descendants all these lands, and in your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge. He kept my commandments, he kept my statutes, and he kept my laws." So Isaac dwelt in Gerar. In verses 7 through 14, you see it begin to take place as Isaac obeyed what the Lord told him to do. Verse 13 says, "Then the man began to prosper." You better watch out when you begin to be successful. "Then the man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. And he had possessions of flocks and possessions of herds and a great number of servants, so the Philistines envied him." Verse 15. "Now the Philistines had stopped up all the wells which his father's servants had dug in the days of Abraham his father. And they had filled them with earth," or they had filled them with dirt. "And Abimelech said to Isaac, 'Go away from us, for you are much mightier than we.' Then Isaac departed from there and pitched his tent in the valley of Gerar and dwelt there. And Isaac dug again the wells of water which they had dug in the days of Abraham his father, for the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. And he called them by the names which his father had called them. Also Isaac's servants dug in the valley and found a well running water there. But the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herdsmen, saying, 'The water is ours.' So he called the name of the well Esek, because they quarreled with him. Then they dug another well, and they quarreled with him over that one as well, so he called its name Sitnah." Verse 22. "And they moved from there and dug yet another well, and they did not quarrel over it. So he called its name Rehoboth, because he said, 'For now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land.' Then he went up from there to Beersheba, and the Lord appeared to him the same night and said, 'I am the Lord God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendants for my servant Abraham's sake.' So he built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord. And he pitched his tent there, and there Isaac's servants dug a well." I want to speak to you for just a few moments this morning from the subject, "Let's dig some new wells." Let's dig some new wells. Lord, help me this morning. I've already felt my helper in this room this morning, but I pray, God, let the words that would come from my mouth this morning not be my own, but be the words that you would have me to speak. Lord, help us to receive this morning what thus saith the Lord, and Lord, crown this altar service with the presence of God, and we'll be sure to give you all the praise and all the glory. And everybody said, amen. God bless you as you're seated. This morning, I've got to move quickly. I have, and I don't want to disturb you, but I have 9 pages of notes this morning. And so we'll move fast. Put your purse down. Don't get up and run off. We'll move quickly to the point this morning. Please come back tonight. Tonight, we will be honoring Brother Brinkle in the service. Last week was his birthday. He was 86 years old last Sunday morning. And tonight in the service, we will honor Brother Brinkle. So please come back tonight and be a part of that. I know this morning there are people that are facing many different kinds of trials. There are people in the room, and I'm talking to us today. Look at your neighbor and say, he's talking to you. I'm talking to us today. We could talk to the entire church as across the board, but today I'm talking to us about digging some new wells. We are starting the first of the year, and I probably should have started this at the very beginning of January, but this is where the Lord allowed me to preach it, so here we go. We are starting 2016, so it is time for you to dig some new wells. You cannot continue to do the same thing over and over and over and expect a different result. Somebody say amen. You've got to dig some new wells in your life. And so I know today in this room there are people that are facing different kind of trials and different kind of struggles. There are people here today that are needing jobs and those that are needing healings in their body. Those that are needing a healing in their marriage and a healing in their home. And I want to encourage you this morning as we get started into this. I want to encourage you that if you are at the end of your rope this morning, what you should do is tie a knot and hang on, because help is on the way. I said, if you're at the end of your rope this morning and you would say, Pastor, I don't know what else to do, you are in the right place for a miracle from God when you don't know what else to do. When you've gotten yourself out of the way and you can receive Yahweh's way, then you are right where he wants you to be. Somebody say amen. It's a fact that all of us this morning in this room, we are aware that we face trial after trial as a believer. At times we go through trial after trial, and that life along the way, we are confronted in life with just difficult times. Anybody ever just faced a difficult time? Jesus never promised that this walk would be cotton candy and roses. He never said everything will be all right. He never said that if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that you will not struggle. But what he did promise, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, even though there are difficult days and difficult times, I will never walk away from you. In fact, in a person's life, our life story could be easily written by headlining the major trials of our lives and describing how we have dealt with those trials. This is exactly how Isaac's life in the scripture that I've read to you, how his life is recorded. And this is the only chapter in which Isaac is the main character. This chapter focuses on Isaac himself. His life is covered by highlighting the trials that he had to face. I believe that we as followers of Jesus Christ have much to learn by applying the life lessons found that I'm going to talk to you about this morning, by the life lessons of Isaac found in this chapter. You would do yourself well to go home this afternoon and read Genesis chapter 26 and let the Lord speak to you, because at times it seems like we have a life that's filled with great difficulties. Anybody facing a difficulty today? It seems like that life is full of great difficulties, and even Isaac's life was filled with blessing. He along the way had blessing and glories in his life, but he fought some real battles, and so will you. in Isaac's life, and I won't preach about those today, we're talking about digging new wells, but in Isaac's life, his life was filled with blessing and with glory as well. But as he fought some real battles, those blessings came. Listen, without risk, there is no reward. I said, without risk, there is no reward. There is some risk along the way, and there is some difficulty along the way, but God will never be in debt to no man or to no woman, and he will always send the blessing if you'll make it through the fight. Come on, somebody. You're not left there to fight on your own. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. It doesn't say, yea, though I sit down in the valley of the shadow of death. Listen, if he be my helper today, I can keep walking through the valley. I can keep walking through the difficulty. If God is on my side, am I talking to anybody today? If God is on my side, then I know he has a way and a plan of escape for me. So let's look this morning at a couple of battles that Isaac was required to fight. Number one, this morning, he faced the problems, he faced difficulties, he faced problems with the world. The Bible tells us that the Philistines were jealous of Isaac. I just read it to you in the scripture. The Philistines said to Isaac, get away from us, go away from us because you appear to be, or you are mightier than we, or you are better than we at this. And so they were jealous of him. Listen to me this morning. The devil is jealous of what you have this morning. I said the devil is jealous of what you have this morning, not because of your Cadillac and not because of your big house or your pretty suit. The devil is jealous because you have victory this morning. I said, because you have victory this morning and you have the shed blood of Jesus Christ applied to your life. Well, some of us do. So he's jealous. And because they could see the hand of God upon his life, they were jealous. He was prospering while they were struggling. Because they were jealous, they tried to make his life hard by plugging up the wells that had been dug by his father. Now hold on, pay attention with me this morning. You've got to get this or you'll miss the rest of the sermon. They tried to make his life hard by plugging up the wells, by stopping up the wells, by damming up the wells that had been dug by his father. Listen to me, that's the very same thing that's taking place in the world that you and I live in today. The devil is trying to stop the move of God that was set forward by our forefathers. Come on, somebody. The enemy would love nothing better than this thing of Pentecost to go downhill. Come on, people are driving by right now out of the parking lot looking for your car to see if you are here, and they are making fun of you, and they are accusing us this morning of jumping pews and swinging from chandeliers and speaking in tongues, and I think we ought to do everything they are accusing us of this morning. They would love nothing better than to stop the work that has been done before us. Are you watching the news today? Are you paying attention to what's going on in our world today? The world that you live in, the world that I live in, the government that's supposed to be serving you, that's supposed to be serving us, would love nothing better than to stop what we're doing this morning. But Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. God has a plan for his church, and I want to know this morning, or are you his church? I see some of you looking down. You're embarrassed and you just put your head down and don't look either way. But listen to me. The Bible said that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The world would love nothing better than to stop what we're doing this morning. Listen to me. I'm prophesying to the church this morning that there's going to come a day that if you don't get involved now, there's coming a day, if Jesus tarries in this world, that you will wish you had gotten involved. You will wish you had gone to an altar. You will wish you had showed up to church. There's coming a day of persecution that you're going to face and I'm going to face, and there will be a day that you will say, I wish I would have gotten involved. I wish I wouldn't have let my friends keep me from that altar. I wish I wouldn't have let my pride keep me in the pew. I wish I wouldn't have let my thoughts keep me from serving Jesus Christ. Listen to me this morning. It's not in my notes, but I know sin, the Bible said, is pleasurable for a season. That means it's fun for a time, but that season is over. I said that season comes to an end. There's time to stop all the foolishness. Come on, somebody. There's time to stop all of the foolishness. And you may think you've covered your sin today. You may think you've hid from your pastor today. And you may have, but you'll never hide from God. Whew, come on, I was a teenager one time, and I thought my mother was the dumbest person on the face of the earth. Anybody else thought the same thing? I won't look at the section here in the middle. I'll just bypass them. Come on, anybody else thought your parents were old-fashioned? One, two, three. Anybody else thought your choir, y'all are honest, anybody else thought your parents were so far behind the times? Come on, they were nerds. Let's just get down to where we were nerds. They were geeks. What do y'all call them today? There wasn't a word from this section right here. There was a day I thought my mother was the weirdest person on the face of the earth. She would say to me all along, you better pay attention to the time that you live in. The time you're living, when I was living at home, she'd say, this is the best time of your life. This is the best time of your life. You've got it made, and you don't even know that you've got made, you've got it. She said, I wash your clothes, and I cook you. You wait till you're out. I thought, lady, you are crazy. Am I helping somebody now? I may not be at your house, but I'm in your neighborhood. I thought, lady, you're crazy. This isn't the best time of my life. You let me bust out of this place and get into college, and I'm going to show you what having a time is. Ooh, I got out on my own, and something happened. When I got out on my own and living in Arkadelphia at Henderson State University, I had been there about a month, Pastor Torin. And I went down to check on my mail. I went to open the mailbox, and there was something in there from Allstate, and there was something in there from the car payment, and there was something. I said, I called my mother. I said, there must be a mistake. They followed me to Arkadelphia. I said, I got the car payment, I got the insurance, and I got the payment on this place I'm staying at. She said, well, honey, you wanted to be on your own, so I thought I'd just let you see what it's like being on your own. There's coming reality for you one day, that reality is going to strike when Jesus comes, and I want to know, are you ready to face reality? Oh, I'm just sowing my wild oats, Pastor. Jesus gets me. He gets me. He's going to wait on me. He's going to wait till I get done running around, and I'll just leave that right where it's at, running around. He's going to wait till I can get it right. You know, I'm in my 20s, I'm in my early 30s, I'm not married, and I'm living it up. He's going to wait on me. Jesus will wait on no man and no woman. We'll come back there. Just as it was with Isaac, the Lord's elect or the Lord's chosen should never expect to be accepted or understood by the world. Today, if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, the world cannot understand how you're living. They cannot understand how you're talking. They cannot understand why you're praising. They cannot understand why you get up and go to church on Sunday morning and some on Sunday night and less on Wednesday night. They don't get it. But it's because there's been a change. I said it's because... The fact of the matter is, the Lord tells us clearly that those who live for Him will be persecuted as they pass through this world. 2 Timothy Chapter 3, verse 12 through 15 says, yes, and all who desire to be godly and live in Jesus Christ will suffer persecution. But evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue in the things you have learned and have been assured of, knowing from who you have learned them, and that they, from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Well, Pastor, you know, I'm not up for that persecution stuff, so I quit. You know, I'm not up for that hard living. I'm up to live on easy street. I'm not up for that. Listen to me. I lived in the world for a number of years, and I'd a whole lot rather be right where I am today than ever going back there if they gave me triple what I had when I was out there. Come on, I'm speaking to you prophetically. I can come and get you this morning. I could walk back there and get you this morning, ma'am. I see it on your face this morning. You came because somebody asked you. You came this morning because somebody required you and woke you up this morning. But you are not here because they invited you. The Bible says, no man cometh to God except the Holy Spirit draws you. This is a word from God for you today, and you must dig some new wells this morning. I haven't even got to preaching yet. Of course, some of the tactics the Philistines used against Isaac are still being employed against the people of God today. They become jealous when they can't explain or understand our peace and joy under trials. They do their best to rob us of the blessings we have as children of God when they see us walking by faith through this world. But you are sick, but God has healed me. But you're struggling financially, but God be my provider. But you are bound today, but God be my deliverer today. If you're walking by faith, we go by not what we see. Listen, the problem is, well, Pastor, I don't feel like it. Oh, I don't feel like going to church. I don't feel like worshiping. I don't feel like it's the right thing. That's the problem. We're living by feelings. We live by emotion. Come on, I'll preach it to you at some point. David got all messed up in his life because he said, I thought in my heart. He thought in his heart. Listen to me this morning. Your heart will lie to you. Your heart will tell you lies. The enemy, and then he does a good job by sitting on your shoulder. Come on. To take away our faith. Come on, today, anybody ever whittled? You whittle, take a knife and whittle on a stick. The end result is to make something. Some of us just whittle to be whittling. Some of us would whittle because we're bored. But what happens when you're whittling, you just take away a little at a time. It's just a little at a time until you finally get whatever it is that you have intended to make down to that. That's exactly what the enemy does to the believer today, is he slowly whittles away at your faith. Slowly whittles away. Well, God didn't bless you, and God didn't show up, and God didn't do that, and he didn't do that. He's good at accusations and slowly whittling you down to what he wants you to be. And that's exactly what he's done to the church for years, and he's just about got it where he wants it. We're people of faith. We don't go by what we see. We don't live by what we see. We don't live with the circumstances. Who told you it was okay to get under the circumstances? They will seek to stop up the wells in our lives from which we are drawing through discouragement, through intimidation, through personal attacks, and through embarrassment. Yet the Lord said that it would be this way, and he tells us to rejoice when this kind of situation arises in our lives. Come on now, I know this morning that we live in a, for the lack of another word, I know that we live in a bubble. We live in a pretty much a protected area. Come on, as a believer, you know where to go and where not to go, where you can stay away from things. Come on, you know how, but all the more we see the time coming. Jesus said that there would be difficult times, there would be persecutions, and they would do all of these things to stop the water from flowing in your life. Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 through 12 said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil things against you, you falsely for my sake." Verse 12 says, "Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, so that they persecute the prophets who went before you." We should take it as a compliment at times from hell for the struggles that you go through in your life, because you must be doing something right. I said, you must be doing something right. You must be headed towards the right way. If you're facing all kinds of new devils at times, come on somebody, we should take it as a compliment from hell because you're doing the right thing. "Well, Pastor, I don't have any problems. Everything's good for me. I got a bank account full of money, never been sick. My kids are all saved, driving us something. Come down to this altar, because let me tell you, serving Jesus Christ, there's some difficult days along the way." So when the world turns against you and your family and turns against the church, the people of the church should not be surprised and should not be upset, but yet we should rejoice in the Lord. Listen, our better days are not behind us. Our better days are before us. I said, "Oh, Pastor, I remember the revival we had. Ooh, when I was you 85. I remember the revival we had when I was in junior high. I remember Pensacola. I remember this." Listen, I praise God for all those moves of God. But listen, if there's going to be an ushering of souls into the church in the last days, we've got to have a better revival than those days. We've got to have something bigger, and we got to have something more powerful, and we got to have... Number two, he faced problems with his wells. In verses 17 through 22, I read it to you in the beginning. You see that the Philistines, they were stopping the wells up. They were plugging the wells with the earth. They were filling those wells with dirt so that the water would stop flowing. We already know that the Philistines had plugged those wells that Abraham, Isaac's father, had dug. He plugged those wells, but they even fought Isaac over the new wells that he was digging in the wilderness. Why all this fascination with wells, Pastor? Why all this fascination and talking about wells? Well, there are several reasons. One, the primary one being the fact that men and animals, you and I, must have water to survive. And water is designed and used to represent the Word of God. Anytime that you read the Word of God, it is equal. Water is equal to the Word of God. And listen to me, in these last days, the enemy would like nothing better to do than to stop the Word of God up from coming to pass in your life. This is what will get you victory. This is what will get you healed. This is what will get you victory. It's not the president. It's not the mayor. It's not your husband. It's not your spouse. It's the Word. I said it's the living Word of Jesus Christ that will deliver you. "Oh, Pastor, I'm waiting on the next Oprah show tomorrow so she can tell me how to get victory." All Oprah wants is your money. "Well, you know, Dr. Phil, when he comes on, he's a smart man. And he'll tell me." Keep watching that, and you'll keep having what you've had. "Well, you know, I've heard it said," and I'm not going to get into this today, but I've heard it said, I don't know how many times me, in the past several months, "I can't wait till the election in 2016. Well, I can't either. I can't either, but I'm not banking on that to bring me victory. I'm not banking on that to get me out of trouble. I'm not I'm not banking on Donald Trump or anybody else to save this country, because it's going just like Jesus said. He said, when you hear wars and rumors of wars and sickness and difficulty, he said, look up, because your redemption draweth nigh. Jesus is coming. You won't know what's wrong with this world today. This word is coming to pass, and you cannot stop it. I said, you cannot stop it. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. This is the victory in your life. Israel drank it in. They drank it in as a figure of the word of God. When they drank the water in the wilderness from the rock, which represented Christ. Exodus chapter 17 verse 6 said, behold, I will stand before you on the rock of Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 4 said, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of the spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Listen to me today. The enemy would do nothing better, like nothing better than to stop the well of water that flows through this sanctuary, that flows through your marriage. Is anybody with me today? The enemy would like nothing better than to stop the promises of God from coming to pass in your life, because that's where you give up. When I stop seeing God working, I stop serving God. Well, he did it for so-and-so, but he didn't do it for me. Get your attitude fixed and he'll do it for you. Listen, I don't serve God for what he does for me. I serve him for what he did on that cross. I don't serve God for the blessings. I praise God for a nice suit of clothes. I praise God for nice shoes. Hey, say amen. I praise God for good health, but I praise him because he saved me. I got my ticket punched. He's poured his blood out for me in order that I can be free and I can spend eternity with him and not with the enemy. Somebody say amen. If you can't get excited about that, then please come down here and we will anoint you with oil, and we will pray that your exciter will get healed this morning in these last days. Don't get excited about your 401k. Don't get excited about your girlfriend or your boyfriend or the next election. You better get excited that Jesus is coming back for his church that's without spot or without wrinkle. Woo! Woo, I feel like preaching now. I didn't feel like preaching when I got here this morning, but I thank my helper. I thank the helper showing up, and it's 11:15. Jesus, can I take this off? I'm sorry if it's a... Sorry. Jesus likens his word to a supply of living water. This word is living water for your soul that is thirsty and that's hurting and that's desperate. And you go from man to man to man and woman to woman to woman trying to find satisfaction. Let me tell you, he said, I will fill the void where there's an empty place in your life. I will become that which you need if you'll just let me in. Whew. John chapter 4 verse 10. He likens his word to a supply of living water. Jesus answered her and said, if you knew the gift of God, if you knew, speaking to the woman at the well, he said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that's talking to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. And the woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and with the well, because the well is deep. Where then do you get the living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his son and his livestock? Verse 13, Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks this living water again will never thirst, but whoever drinks the water that I shall give him will never ever thirst again. But the water that I shall give him will become him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. This word today is everlasting life. Come on, if we were to take a poll in this room today and everybody were to be honest, did you read your Bible yesterday? Did you read your Bible Friday? Did you read it Thursday? Did you read it? Did you read it any? Have you ever read the Bible? Come on, this is an instruction manual for your life. You want to know how to live free, drug-free, happy, and you don't have to stay in bed all day long and depressed? The answer is found right here. You want to know how to keep from cheating on your husband? The answer is found in this book right here. You want to know how to live above sin? The answer is found in this book right here. This isn't going real well. A friend of mine's house burned completely to the ground. I think I told you this. Burned completely to the ground. And lost everything he had in that house. This guy's a multimillionaire. I thought, man, he's going to get all kinds of money back for that. I played golf with his insurance agent. I called his name. I said, man, I'll bet he gets back a lot of money from his house burning to the ground. And the guy said to me, his insurance agent said, no. In fact, he won't even get back half of what he had in that house. I said, why not? I said, he's a millionaire. He said, well, there were certain clauses on his insurance policy that he did not read. And so therefore, when he came to the insurance company to claim his check, he didn't know what to ask for. He could have got far more than what he asked for, but because he didn't read the insurance policy, he settled for less. That's exactly where the church lives today. We settle for less because we don't know what the insurance policy says. We don't know what the insurance policy says. He's a healer. He's a deliverer. He's the baptizer. He's the savior. He's my father. He's my friend. He's become everything, and I know it through this word. Ooh, I wish he'd calm down. I wish he'd calm down so we can go to lunch. Maybe I ought to reconsider my vote. It's the truth. Hosea 4 and 6 said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Didn't say my people are destroyed for their cultures. I'm so tired of hearing that, I don't know what to do. Our culture. I understand culture. I pastored a multi-faceted church in Houston. I had people in my church there in Houston at any given time. In any service, we had people in my service from over 33 countries around the world. I get diversity and I get culture. But listen, he wrote one book. I said he wrote one book for his people. It's not about culture. It's about knowing what thus saith the Lord for my life. Let me move on. I got to skip a whole bunch. I'm only on page 5. In that country where Jesus was speaking to the woman at the well, it was a semi-desert if you go back and study it. It was a semi-desert, and water was as valuable then as oil used to be here. In those days, all wastelands were called God lands. Go back and study it. If any man could live in a desert place during that time and provide for his family and for his flocks, and an open well was there, then that land was considered to be his land. In other words, a well was a statement of ownership. If you owned a piece of property back in this time that I just read to you, if you had a piece of property, even though it was in a semi-desert land, anybody felt like you was living in a desert place at time, but you've got a well. Somebody say amen. You've got a well. And if you've got a well, then you've got ownership. This Bible is ownership to me. I own healing. I own prosperity. I own blessing. I own everything because it's the living word of God for me and for you. So to fill in a well, here we go, we're about to get to the point of this whole thing. To own a well during that time meant ownership. But to fill in a well was an act of war. To own the well was an act of ownership. I can take ownership of this Bible. I'm an heir. I'm a joint heir with Jesus. Everything, I don't have time to preach this today, but everything he had and everything he did, I can have and do too. You can do too. There may be something right there we can preach on. I'm not sure if we believe that or not. Well, but Pastor, he cast out demons. Well, you can too. Well, Pastor, he raised the dead. Well, you can too. Well, he healed the sick. Well, you can too. Well, the lame, well, you can too. Why are we not? To fill in a well was an act of war. Let me go back to catch you back up. The well represented living water. It was life to the people. In the word, water is representative of the word. And to fill in that well or stop the flow of water, then it was an act of war. The Philistines hated Isaac so much that they declared war on him by trying to seize his lands, to take away what was his and drive him far from the country that was given to him. Is that not what's taking place in our world today? Is that the enemy is trying to take the well from you and I, what was started years ago, and is trying to drive us far from what we know to be true? Come on, somebody. And the church daily is giving them rope. It was an act of war to stop up my well. Come on, are you there? Are you there with me? I've worked hard to dig this well. I've worked hard to build this church. We've worked hard to get all these people here. We've done everything we can do to make this happen. I spent blood, sweat, and tears building this well, and you came to stop up my well. The fight's on, buddy. Listen, if the church is going to be the church in the last days, somebody's got to stand up and fight. Somebody's got to stand up and fight and take and hold on to what is theirs. And I want to know, is that going to be you? And is that going to be me? Or are we just going to sit back and let the devil come and take everything we've got? And I submit to you, the latter is the answer. Come on. You know people that ought to be here today. There's people laying on their couch right now in this city that live next door to you, that work with you, that don't even know what happened last night. Can't remember who they were with. If the church is going to be the church in the last days, somebody's got to fight for these wells. Somebody's got to stand up and say, no, in Jesus' name. I want to pastor a church where folks will charge hell with a water pistol. First time the enemy says, boo, we skip church for a month. Notice the fights that he had to undertake. He had to clean out the old wells. Verse 18. And Isaac dug again the well of water which they had dug in the days of Abraham, his father. For the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He called them by the names which his father had called them. This is very important. Many years before his father Abraham had passed through the land, he had dug water wells. He dug those wells to meet the needs in his day and to pass them down to his son Isaac so that needs could be met in his day as well. You didn't get it. Abraham passed through the land and he recognized, I got a son. That's going to have to benefit from what I've done. He's coming behind me, and he's going to have this well of living water as well. He's going to have this as well. I praise God today for the people that have poured out their blood, sweat, and tears to build this church. I praise God for the Johnson family and the work that they have done to ensure that you have a fabulous place this morning, to have a fabulous place, somebody say amen, to come and worship Jesus Christ. But it doesn't stop there. It must go on, because we must dig wells, and we must protect wells, and we must protect the word, because if Jesus tarries, there's a group of people that's coming behind us, and who are we going to leave that with? Oh, pastor, you know, it's just up to them. We worked hard and got it to where it is, and so they're going to have to work hard and to get it to where it is. No, they should not. That's it. That's it. Ooh, that didn't feel real good. They shouldn't have to work. I mean, we built with our hands this building. We poured with our hands this concrete. We did. Listen, they're not giving away land anymore. There's no reason to go out and build other churches. They should not have to work as hard as you did in building the place because it's already here. What we must be doing is pouring the Pentecost into them that we have received and the fire that we have received and the word that we have received, because if this is going to continue on, that's the way it's going to have to happen. Can I preach a little bit? One, two, three. We're Paul's without Timothy's. We're Paul's without Timothy's. We're expecting the next church to rise up. We're expecting the next church to come up. Listen, I know there's a group right now called the Under 40 group that's trying to tear this Assemblies of God apart. They don't believe in speaking in tongues. They don't believe in anything we believe in. If they hear me preaching this, I'll get all kind of emails, but I can answer you back. The problem is, could be, in that 40 and under group, is that they never had any Pauls. They never had anybody to pray with them at the altar. They never had anybody to get involved with them. They never even, listen, I know, I got three daughters. One's teeny tiny right now, but the other two, I know they listen to different music than I listen to. But if it's Jesus and it's Jesus-centered, then I can get excited about it just like I can I'll Fly Away. Pastor, are you going to change our music? No, that's not what I'm doing. I'm saying that we're Paul's without Timothy's. If we're going to pass these wells on to people that are coming behind us, we've got to get involved in their lives. Many of the wells from which our fathers drank have already been stopped. There's a lot of preachers in this church, a lot of people that came from preacher families, missionary families, evangelist families. This church is full of them. There's people in here can preach better than I can, pray harder than I can, but there are works that your family started that are already stopped because someone chose not to contend for the wells. Just heard yesterday, my father-in-law pastored a church. I won't tell you the town where it was, but he pastored a church south of here. I got to preach in that church a couple of times. And was invited to come preach. I'm telling you, we'd have church, Brother Torin. We'd have church all over that place. He would have them so fired up when you get in there, you could preach the three bears and they'd just spin on their head. I'd go in and preach Jesus wept. And they would cry, shout, holler, run, jump the pews. They were ready for Jesus. My father-in-law told me yesterday, he closed that church down. Closed the church down because people decided it wasn't worth it anymore. The well stopped up. There'll be people in that town that will bust hell wide open because people were not willing to contend for the flow of God's water in that place. The truth. Somebody come to the piano. Let me hurry. I may just have to finish this next Sunday. I'm not waiting on your vote. I'm trying to find where I was in my notes. Just be honest. Thank you for the vote, but I was really trying to find where I was at. Somebody said, yes, do it. And I heard another one over here, no, please don't do it. Please, please stop. Lose his place. Joni and I, my girls, we lived in Houston for 14 years. I don't know how many trips we made from Houston to here or to Malvern. In 14 years, I don't know how many trips, lots and lots of trips. And there are a lot of trips we would leave on Sunday afternoon in the past 5 years. And there's reasons for that. My church that I pastored had been through a very, very difficult time when I got the church. It had ran about 700, 750 at one point. When I got there, was voted in my first service in that church. I had 15 people. They had canceled Sunday night because they had just lost everybody. And Sunday night service is my favorite service. I mean, I love them all. I love them all. But there's just something about Sunday night. The old folks used to say you can just let the rough edges drag on Sunday night. Nobody's worried about getting to their pot roast and beating the Baptist to the buffet and finding the best parking lot at Western Sizzlin'. Sunday night, they couldn't care less. Just lean back and let it go. And so we didn't have service there. It was disappointing to me. So I started some throughout the year and we would have them. But we would leave Houston and come home on some Sunday afternoons for holidays and other reasons. And on Highway 59 out of Houston, coming north, and then you get to I-30 at Texarkana, there's no telling how many churches we passed. Quite honestly, probably hundreds, probably a few hundred, and probably some more that I never could see. Just the ones that we could see, there would only be three or four that would be having service on Sunday night. It's grievous to me because, first of all, the building's there and we're paying for it. Why not use it? Second of all, we've got to create atmospheres where God can do miracles in these last days. Sunday morning, I'm on a time schedule. In fact, I'm supposed to be done right now. I'm supposed to be saying amen to let you go right now. So I'll apologize in advance. But I hadn't kept you late yet. This is the first time. So we put God in a box and say, you've got an hour. You've got an hour. I'm going to give you an hour on Sunday morning. You got an hour to change my life. You got an hour to do miracles. You got an hour. If you can't get it done in that hour, too bad. I'll see you next Sunday. So many of the wells have already stopped up and basically have just been shut down. And then we wonder why is happening in this country what's happening. Think about it with me just for a moment. I'm getting to the end. There used to be a day when God's people drank from the well of praise and worship. I remember I shared with Sister Johnson. She's from the same church I am there in Malvern, Arkansas. I remember days in that old church, Pastor Larry Moore preaching. And as I told you before, all the grannies, they would all sit over here. They didn't care what you thought. They didn't care if the president was at church. They didn't care if the general superintendent was at church. They didn't care who was there. When they'd strike a chord on that piano, those grannies were up and they were ready to have church. And they'd dance around. They weren't ashamed. Come on, they weren't ashamed for somebody to take off, 86-year-old man to take off running around the saint. They weren't ashamed by that. In fact, some of them would probably knock you down, running over you. But we've become more civilized over the years. There used to be a day when we came to church to drink from the well. The world has stopped that well by telling us that we should not be fanatics for Jesus. That there are other ways through Islam. There are other ways to Jesus through good works. There's other ways to heaven. Just be a good person. You're a champion and find the champion in you. Everything's going to be all right. And so we've stopped the well. There used to be a day when I don't remember a clock. They didn't care. If you were taking medicine or if it was time for you to go, just go. We're going to have church with the ones that want to stay. And when they came down, I remember as a kid, I'm not trying to prolong this, but I'm talking about a day. There used to be a time, and it happens in this church. I've already seen it, and I praise God for it. There used to be a day when I, as a child, a teenager, come down to the altar. It wasn't now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep, and get up and go back to my pew. There was some granny or some grandpa, somebody standing over the back of you with their hand on the back of your head, and you didn't get up until they were finished. Come on, you didn't get up. There'd be wet tears dripping down on the back of your head. And I would think I was done and start to get up, and they'd push me right back down. Come on, I would think they would take a break to wipe the snot off their face, and I'd think, oh, that's it. And I'd try to slip away, and they'd put me right back. There used to be a day. There's a need right now for God's people to redig the wells that the world has tried to stop up. Some of you are in this room today, you need to redig a well in your life. You're stopped up with so much junk. You stopped up with pornography. You stopped up with sexual things. You stopped up with addictions. You stopped up with pride. You stopped up with anger. You stopped up with vengeance. You stopped up with... You need to redig the well in your life. Wish we had more time. The names of the wells, I got to share this with you, and then I'll find somewhere to stop. The names of those wells there that Abraham named them are very important. One of the wells he named was called Esek. That word Esek means contention. Abraham named that well Esek because it was contention. It was a well of arguing. It was a well of fighting. It was a well of pride. And listen, we can't stand for that well to be in the church today. Come on, we can't have that well in the church today. We don't need to be fighting. We need to come together. Today's not an idea. Pastor, I don't like how you preach. Pray for me. God will speak to me and I'll change. Maybe. We don't need to be fighting. We can do enough of that out there. We're supposed to be loving. We're supposed to be caring. We're supposed to be forgiving. Jesus forgave you, so why can we not forgive others? We're supposed to care for each other. The world is supposed to be fighting with each other. He said it's a well of contention. The next well he called was Sitnah. Sitnah means strife or hatred. Abraham said, this is a well of strife and hatred. I can't afford for that well to be in this church. You can't afford for that well to be in your life. You can't afford for that well to flow in your family. It also means a well of laying and waiting to ensnare someone. Did you get that? I know some of you have already turned me off. It means a well of laying and waiting to ensnare someone. You pulled up to church in a car today just looking for something to gripe about. Just looking for a reason to be mad. Just looking for a reason to not come back again. Just looking for a reason to explode. He said, that's a well of Sitnah, and I don't want that. It's all right here. All you got to do is study it. And he moved on to the next place and he dug another well. And your Bible said that at that third well that the Philistines left him alone. And he called that well Rehoboth. Rehoboth means a wide open place. God has a Rehoboth for you. you can get to a place where there's a wide open place for you, where there's no anger and there's no contention and there's no strife, and you don't have to deal. There is a Rehoboth waiting for you. I got to finish. One of our leaders in the state of Texas called me a while back. And I'm telling you, I went through difficulty at the last church I was at. I didn't cause the difficulty. I was reaping in a field I didn't sow. But I was there to try to help put it back together, and with God's help we did. Left them in an awesome place. And one of our leaders, Pastor Gary, in Texas, I won't tell you where, called me one day, had really no idea what I was going through. No idea. In fact, when I answered the phone and he said his name, I was shocked that he was calling me. And he said, I was praying the other day because I've heard of a few of the things you've been going through. And he said, the Lord gave me a word for you. And he said, I hope that you will receive it. I said, hey, lay it on me. I need it. This was before this ever came about. He said, the Lord spoke to me and called and said to tell you that he has a Rehoboth prepared for you. He has a Rehoboth prepared, a wide open place where ministry will flourish and souls will be saved. And come on, this is a Rehoboth, and God has a Rehoboth for you. God has a place for you where there's no struggling and there's no contention, and you don't have to struggle and you don't have to be depressed. He can have a Rehoboth for you, but you must redig that well. You've got to redig that well. Isaac had to take a shovel. And if anybody ever been on the working end of a shovel, it's not easy. It's not easy. It's work every time you put it into the ground. There's nothing easy about a shovel. But he knew what the possibilities were because he'd seen his father Abraham do it. And so the work was worth it. And let me tell you today, the work of redigging a well in your life, it's worth it. If I had time today, I'd preach to you. This church, we need to redig the wells of prayer. We need to redig the wells of giving. We need to redig the wells of serving. We need to redig the wells of getting involved in what Jesus Christ wants for this city and for this town. Amen. Lord, don't let the well stop up here. As long as I'm here, this is going to be a thoroughly Pentecostal church. As long as I'm the pastor, we're going to have Sunday night. I may not be able to preach every one of them, but we have a staff and we have folks here that's fully capable of preaching. We're going to be an on-fire Pentecostal church. We're going to sing. We're going to worship. We're going to give. We're going to serve. We're going to praise. We're going to see the lost come to know Jesus. We're going to see the blind healed, and we're going to see the sick healed. We're going to see those that are the furthest from Jesus come to know him. And I want to know, can you get excited about that again? And if you can, I want you to stand to your feet. I want you to throw your hands up and say, Jesus, just do it again in me. Redig this well in me. Redig this well in my life and in this community. God, do it in me. I don't want you to raise your hands just because somebody else is doing it. I want you to raise your hands because you mean it this morning.
I care about the hurt. I care about the wound. I care about that is affecting your life.
What you just witnessed is the gift of the Spirit. You can go home and read about it in Corinthians. Here's what the Lord impressed upon me before the service. Two things. One, if you're here and you have allowed clutter into your well, and you know you're here, this is the day. Pastor, I once knew Jesus, but I've backslid. I've let things into my well this morning. You just heard the word of the Lord, and good is the word of God. Pastor, I've let some things into my heart today. I've let some things that's cluttering this well, and I need to get right with Jesus this morning. If that's you, I want you to come right now. This is a big step. It takes something to do. It takes something. It takes courage to step out today. But listen, don't miss God today. Come on, here comes one, this young lady. She's already made the way easy for somebody else. She's the only one in this house today that has let things into her heart. Come on, if that's you, I want you to come.
Let it breathe.
Pastor, I could stand some cleansing today. I need to get back to Jesus. Maybe you're here today and you've never been saved. You've never asked Jesus into your heart. I want you to come right now. Don't miss this moment. I want you to come stand right here this morning. If that's you, this let's make this a little easier because I know they're here. I could come and get you this morning. I see it on your face. Look at your neighbor and say to them, can I go to the altar and pray with you? Come on. Look at your neighbor. If they say yes, I want you to take them by the hand and come down. Can I go to the altar and pray with you? If that's you, I want you to come. I know you're here. God would not have sent his word like he just did if there weren't someone in this place.
Let it breathe.
Praise God for these that are being honest this morning.
Lord, let it breathe.
Now here's the second part. Pastor, I want that well to flow through me. I want that well to flow through this church and my family. If that's you, I want you to come all around this altar. That's me, Pastor. That's me, Pastor. I need that well this morning. I want that well this morning. I don't want to do anything to stop up that well. I don't want anything. I don't want anything to hinder the word or the water flowing in my life. That's me. I desperately need that today, Pastor. Ooh, I desperately need that. I desperately need that. Hallelujah. Would you just cry out unto God all over this house this morning?